John Henry, he could hammer, he could whistle, he could sing. Went to the mountain early in the morning just to hear his hammer ring. Lord, Lord, just to hear his hammer ring. Just to hear his hammer ring. Lord, Lord, just to hear his hammer ring. When John Henry was a little baby, sitting on his daddy's knee, picked up a hammer and a little piece of steel, said, hammer be the death of me, Lord God, yes, hammer be the death of me. Yes, hammer be the death of me, Lord, Lord, yes, hammer be the death of me. Well, John Henry's family needed money, said he didn't have but a dime. If you wait till the rising sun goes down, I'll get it from the men in the mine. Lord, Lord, I'll get it from the men in the mine. I'll get it from the men in the mine. Lord, Lord, I'll get it from the men in the mine. Well, the captain said to John Henry, John Henry, what can you do? I can hoist a jack, I can lay a track, I can pick and shovel too. Lord God, I can pick and shovel too. I can pick and shovel too. Lordy, Lordy, I can pick and shovel too. Well, John Henry said to the captain, oh, a man ain't nothing but a man. But let your steel drill beat me down. Well, I'll die with the hammer in my hand. Lord God, I'll die with the hammer in my hand. Yes, I'll die with the hammer in my hand. Lord, Lord, I'll die with the hammer in my hand. Well, the captain said to John Henry, I'm gonna bring me a steam drill around. Gonna bring me a steam drill out on the job. Gonna whar that steel on down. Lord, Lord, gonna whar.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to today's webinar, The National Infrastructure Bank Will Rebuild American Industry, brought to you by the National Infrastructure Bank Coalition. My name is Jack Hanna, and I'm a retired attorney and current political activist, having served the Democratic parties of both Pennsylvania and Oregon. Today's webinar is going to focus on how an infrastructure bank is needed at the very moment at this point in time to not only build our ignored infrastructure, but also to reinvigorate and reestablish our country's manufacturing capabilities. America's last real focus of attention on infrastructure was the Highway Act of 1956 under President Eisenhower's administration and the space program of 1960s under Kennedy. Since then, our country's infrastructure has significantly degraded, and that, along with our manufacturing capacity, has diminished. That's not by coincidence. 60 years later, we have not invested in our industries and our economy, and even our national security has suffered because of it. Europe and China are off building high-speed trains and other industrial capabilities while we passively sit by and do nothing. How do we address this failure and increasing crisis? If we look back on our history, it will tell us. We have an answer, and the answer starts with a national infrastructure bank. We began with Washington and Hamilton's launching of the first infrastructure bank our country had, and it enabled us to enter the Industrial Revolution. It helped fund our roads, our canals, our ports, and helped build our cities. It continued under Lincoln, who used an infrastructure bank for funding our emerging railroads and helped create the Transcontinental Railroad, which ran from coast to coast. It was again employed by FDR, who used it to bring America out of the worst economic depression in the country's history and put people back to work and prepared our country for World War II. In each instance, the four infrastructure banks that our country has created were successful in building our country by supporting, financing, and promoting our manufacturing industries. These banks were created because private banking was unable or unwilling to invest and promote the creation of economic efficiencies on a state and national level. Today, after 60 years of half-hearted efforts by our federal and state government trying to promote infrastructure development, by employing deficit financing has been insufficient and indeed has run its course. It's not been enough. We need to employ a new mechanism, a new vehicle, and that is a new infrastructure bank that lends funds to construct and the desperately needed broadband system we need, the communications system above and beyond that, our electrical grid, our transportation system that is inefficient, our water and sewage system that is needed in both rural and urban areas, that will all directly result in increased manufacturing and promote the industries that will reinvigorate and rebound our economy throughout the country. With that, our unemployed and underemployed workforce will be able to produce again the needs of our country and also earn living wages that will further stimulate and improve and grow our economy. Our presenters today will each in their own way describe how a bank will promote the development of our infrastructure and manufacturing simultaneously. We cannot miss this unique opportunity and moment to do so. And now I would like to show our speakers that we are going to have present today. Alfeka Mutardi, a 25-year senior economist formerly with the International Monetary Fund. Andy Kunz, president and CEO of U.S. High Speed Rail Association. The Adonis Rodriguez, New York City councilman, chair of the Transportation Committee. Steven Fenberg, award-winning author of Unprecedented Power, Jesse Jones, Capitalism and the Common Good, and also an Emmy Award producer and writer, Brother, Can You Spare a Billion? Jason Parker, president of the Virginia State Building and Construction Trades Council. Erica White, president of the CWA Local 4319 and vice president of the Northwest Ohio AFL-CIO. Mark Strand, president of the Central New Mexico Central Labor Council. And last but not least, Stan Forsick, infrastructure consultant and a 30-year executive of Amtrak Corporation. So first, let us go to Alfeka Mutardi, our economist, and let me, before tossing it over to her, tell our viewers that we have a question and answer portion as part of this webinar broadcast, and we request that you ask your questions in that portion of the Zoom meeting, and we will get back to you with regard to responding to the questions with answers from our panelists. Now, with that, we'll now move on to Alfeka Mutardi. Alfeka, take it away. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, and good evening, everyone. It's really wonderful to be with all of you this evening to talk about the National Infrastructure Bank. So on the slide that you just saw with my name on it, what we're here to talk about is a bill that's in Congress introduced last year, H.R. 6422, which would create a public bank to lend $4 to $5 trillion for infrastructure projects all across America. We've talked on previous webinars quite a few times about how the bank works. Essentially, it works like a commercial bank to give out loans for infrastructure projects. And the bank is sized to cover all of the projects that cannot be funded by either the federal budget or state and local budgets or public private partnerships. And so this bank at $5 trillion, soon to be reintroduced large, will cover all of those projects. So since today's theme is about how this bank will help to stimulate American manufacturing, I thought I would like for the first time to give you a peek into the bill itself. It's only 25 pages long. If you'd like to read the bill, it's up on our website, nibcoalition.com. But essentially, these are some of the provisions in the bill that would stimulate manufacturing in the United States. So if you could go to the first slide. Yes. So the bill has about 18 different sections in it, but these are ones that focus on how it builds back manufacturing. So the very first opening section of the bill is about findings, and it says that what we want to do is to establish a $5 trillion bank to lend for these infrastructure projects to take us back to our golden days during coming out of the Great Depression and through World War II and winning World War II, when we became a manufacturing powerhouse for the whole world. And during that period, financed by of dollars that came from the Reconstruction Finance Corporation, which Stephen Fenberg is going to talk to you about in a minute, we were able to get growth rates up to the 5% level. We haven't had growth rates averaging that rate since that period of time. And if we can get, because we're spending $5 trillion, because we're going to hire 25 million workers and train them for all these projects, we will be directly and indirectly creating new manufacturing centers for inputs into the construction of the new infrastructure and also all the related industries that grow out of having growth rates at 5% a year. So that's the first thing. Can you go to the next slide? So in the definitions that are in the bill, we have a few definitions. The first one is we talk about connectivity, which we define as connecting manufacturing centers, either with new broadband connections or new high-speed rail connections or other connections that will link together manufacturing centers in the United States, and there's corridors of them all throughout the country.
Alfeka, you're accidentally hit mute.
Thank you for letting me know. Sorry. I don't know how that happened. So we're going to promote connectivity of manufacturing centers, and we're going to develop geographic areas in the country by rehabilitating our infrastructure, constructing it, reconstructing it, rehabilitating it, replacing it, whatever we need in terms of roads, bridges, rail, broadband, new schools. It's a broad definition. So we'll be developing all those things that will need inputs into development that will stimulate manufacturing in the United States. The next slide. We're going to call for the development of regional economic accelerator planning groups. And the purpose for that is so that governors of several states that share a manufacturing corridors, like the whole hub that comes out of Chicago, for example, or the hub that stretches from Birmingham, Alabama, all the way over to North Carolina, which builds all kinds of things. Those manufacturing corridors, we're going to ask those states to come up with regional plans for developing their manufacturing centers, and this bank will support projects in those areas. In addition, we're going to have eligibility criteria to ask for assistance for infrastructure to bolster economic development in those areas. And then in the final slide on section 15, we have a provision in the bill for Buy America only, with no exceptions. So all of the iron, steel, cement, fabricated goods that go into the development of this infrastructure will come from Buy America only. That'll stimulate new development for rail projects, for trains, We could develop manufacturing centers for building wind turbines instead of importing them as we're doing now. All of these will be produced within the United States, and the loans that the NIB gives out will have enough money in them to pay for the goods that are produced in the United States. So the Buy America Only provision will directly and indirectly stimulate manufacturing. And then, as some of our speakers will say, that any firm that wants to move into an area, what they're looking for is good infrastructure, good schools, good municipal utilities, a solid economic grid, and those kinds of things will entice manufacturing companies to come back to the United States from overseas and produce their goods here. So that's it in a nutshell. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you. Now I needed to unmute. Thank you very much, Alfeka. Next up, we're going to have Andy Kuntz, the president and CEO of U.S. High Speed Rail Association. Andy, a pleasure to have you here again today, and we look forward to your presentation. Thank you.
Thank you for having me. If we could have my slideshow. I appreciate being here, appreciate being part of the mission of the bank. High-speed rail is one of the big components in the bank's planning, and it has so many beneficial aspects to the United States that it's really almost it alone would make this a great purpose. So basically, we started the association in 2009 with the mission to specifically build widespread public, business, and political support for a major investment in a national high-speed rail network. And so this was prior to this bank. And so our mission and the bank's mission actually worked very well together, that you know, we were already sort of working in the same direction for the same sort of a large investment. Next, I think we lost the slideshow. Okay, so there's our national vision that we launched when we launched the association. And the idea with this was that it's similar to our interstate highway system. It was a connected network that literally pulled the whole country together into a modern, it's basically the 21st century highway system for the country, but it's based on advanced rail rather than the older modes. Next slide, please. So when we launched the association, we launched that vision, and along with it, this idea of a complete transportation system. And when you're missing rail, which is a big important component in the middle, which you can see here on the left are the more local, on the right is the more national, and the middle section was where rail serves the most, and it's completely missing in this country. So we end up with overloading aviation, trying to take up some of the slack, and overloading the car system to take up some of the slack, causing both of them to malfunction as well. So that's why it's important to actually build out a complete system, get the pieces in that are missing that actually can handle huge quantities of people and goods. And then that sort of makes all the rest of the transportation system work more smoothly in the country. Next slide, please. So part of this idea of the complete transportation system includes rail at multi-levels. So we've got the national high-speed rail network for the large-scale, big bulk transportation, longer distances, main trunk lines around the country. Then that ties in with regional commuter and metro systems that cover a local region. And then that ties in with local trams and streetcar systems, which cover the neighborhood and the town and the city scale. And then the fourth level would be an extensive bicycle network. And when you add and a walking, you know, the ability to actually walk in a city, you add all those together, you end up with a complete green transportation system that literally builds prosperity in the country as we go forward. Next slide, please. And so the final piece of that is the urbanism and the development and the walkability and the mixed use that gets infilled closely around the stations, creating complete communities with dense walkable mixed use. And this is where you can really provide large quantities of affordable housing, because the ability to move around and live without the expense of a car literally creates affordable housing just by that. And then the close proximity and the easy access to jobs and things by the rail system keeps your transportation costs very low as well. Next slide, please. So we were moving along with all this, and then COVID comes along and disrupts our whole world and turns everything upside down. And next slide, kind of leaves us with the point of now we're all looking forward to returning to normal, but what really is normal in transportation is our question. And is this really what we want to return to? Next. When you think back, a lot of people probably forgot a lot of this because it's been over a year since we really had these kind of levels, but this is what we were dealing with day in and day out in all of our transportation systems: overloaded, failing, endless waste of time and energy sitting around waiting for things to move, being stuck behind lines and lines of cars, lines of people. It's not an efficient way to move a country, especially a big prosperous country like the United States. So next slide. Our idea with, you know, and this is some of the things spelled out of what we actually had: epic congestion daily in every region, nonstop accidents, injuries and deaths, constant delays and hassles. Transportation currently is the number one cause of climate change. So we're paying high costs and we're getting low mobility out of it. Yet we're actually, as a nation, spending hundreds of billions of dollars every year on this system, and it just keeps getting worse. So the whole idea of the way we fund transportation needs to change, and how what we fund and what we invest in needs to change. And that's where we feel that this bank would have a big role to play in that sort of a shift of the paradigm. Next slide. And so, what, you know, our ideas again is we can do better than this with a new direction in transportation. Next. And this idea gels perfectly with the Biden administration, the whole idea of build back better. That's now the new theme that's sort of permeating the country. And we agree with it 100%. This is what a better vision for transportation looks like in America. Next, please. And so what we did quickly was we laid out a stimulus plan for the Biden administration just to get started. And we came up with 15 projects that could be fast-tracked, that'll create millions of jobs, and are literally, a number of them are actually ready to go or already under construction, like California. So next, please. And so these are the first five that we felt were the highest priority. These, again, as I said, some of these are, California's already under construction. There's additional phases that can be funded. These can be quickly moved into creating immediate jobs. These are the most shovel-ready projects in the country, all except for number four, which is a fast-moving one. We put it in here because of the leadership with Microsoft and everybody that's behind that project. Next one, please. And then we listed out 10 more projects to actually get started and get pieces of the national network underway. And the idea with these is that they'll spread the wealth throughout numerous regions of the country, create jobs in all sorts of regions where there's jobs needed: coastal regions, interior regions, north, south, red states, blue states. That was really the idea behind this, was to build pieces of the national network that we need, but do it in a phasing way that we can bring all of Americans along. Next slide, please. And there's what it looks like on a map. Those are all pieces of our national vision for the country. And as you can see, a few of these only need a few more pieces. And then all of a sudden you've got big main lines that go 1,000 miles covering numerous states and numerous connections. Next, please. And as I said, these 15 projects will benefit 23 states, red and blue, urban and rural, in a variety of diverse regions, and will help America bounce back quickly from the pandemic and the resulting economic depression, and help unify a divided nation over a common infrastructure project that will literally set up the nation for a very prosperous and sustainable future. Next, please. So Alfeca asked me to actually look at what the bank is proposing, $1 trillion investment over a 10-year time span. And this is what this slide is about, is basically the general industry accepted number for approximate numbers of jobs that are created per dollars invested is about 10,000 jobs for every $1 billion investment. That, of course, varies up and down depending on details, but that's a good average number. So investing $100 billion per year for 10 years will literally create 1 million new jobs every single year year after year for 10 years straight. And then when the system is completed, the construction, there'll be millions of jobs to actually run it and manage it. And those jobs go into perpetuity. So it's a million job creator, a 10 million job creator to build the system, and then a multi-million dollar permanent job creator for all the operations and maintenance and everything. And then all the development that will take place around the stations is just millions more jobs. So that's pretty much kind of the summary of this and how important this would be for the nation. It's a major solution to affordable housing, a major climate solution, a major job solution. And doing all this will literally revamp and revitalize the entire manufacturing sector of the United States that was pretty much shuttered over the years from moving things to China and other countries. So thank you all for your attention.
Thank you for your presentation, Andy. Great to hear about the plans for our future high-speed rail transportation system here in the country. Next, I'm going to introduce to you our historian and authority with regard to FDR and the author of Unprecedented Power, Jesse Jones, Capitalism and the Common Good, and also an Emmy Award winner and producer of Brother, Can You Spare a Billion? Stephen Fenberg. Stephen, welcome, and we always enjoy your presentation and expertise with regard to Franklin Delano Roosevelt, and the stage is yours.
Thank you, Jack. I'm always so happy to have the job of showing how what my colleagues are talking about really worked. And this is from the Great Depression and World War II. Republican President Herbert Hoover started the RFC, the Reconstruction Finance Corporation, in his last year in office when he realized that the federal government was the only institution large and powerful enough to address the calamity of the Great Depression. Within that last year, he expanded the RFC so that its lending authority almost equaled the entire federal budget. And he included aid to cities and states in what he did. Franklin Roosevelt inherited the RFC from Herbert Hoover and one of its board members, Jesse Jones, who he made its chairman. And under Jesse Jones's leadership, the RFC saved hundreds of thousands of homes, farms, banks, and businesses from bankruptcy and foreclosure, which is so relevant today as we deal with the impacts of the coronavirus. The RFC developed the latest in high-speed rail. It financed it. It made loans to railroads so they could build the latest in high-speed rail cars. It saved the railroads from bankruptcy by refinancing their debt. The RFC built roads, tunnels, bridges throughout the nation. It brought electricity to rural Americans when they only 10% of them had power back then. They lived in the dark. And then it helped them buy appliances on credit so they could plug into the modern age. That was through the Rural Electrification Administration and the Electric Home Farm Administration. And I want to focus on those for just a second as we talk about how an infrastructure bank can expand and multiply industrial production and manufacturing. So the REA brought electricity to rural America when 10% had it, and that was it. 90% lived in the dark. So that meant that through the EHFA, which allowed them to buy appliances on credit, that boosted manufacturing in refrigerators, fans, radios, light bulbs. It employed electricians and plumbers. The industrial expansion was multiplied from the loans the RFC was making. And it's always important to remember, the RFC, our nation's infrastructure bank, was a lending institution, not a spending institution. And those loans were all repaid with a small profit for the federal government and its taxpayers, which is something that I think that we are anticipating with the new infrastructure bank. The RFC converted its focus from domestic economics to global defense as war was spreading through Europe. But by 1936, after FDR's first 4 years in office, it's important to know, as we're talking about industrial expansion, industrial output in the United States doubled from 1929 to 1936. It was producing more cars in 1936 than it had in 1929. And it was all because of the efforts of the Reconstruction Finance Corporation and the other programs of the New Deal that was increasing employment, increasing manufacturing, increasing the industrial base in time to start militarizing for World War II. It really was a national security issue as much as it was an economic issue. So as I said, the RFC converted its focus from domestic economics to global defense and began building the enormous factories that would manufacture the trucks, tanks, ships, and airplanes that were required to fight and win World War II. Our military ranked 17th in the world in 1940 when Jesse Jones and the RFC began to build this massive industrial base. The RFC invested in aviation alone 10 times more than the industry had invested in itself throughout its entire history. By the end of the war, the RFC owned 70% of the aviation industry. The way it would work, the RFC would build these enormous plants and lease them to corporations to operate. After the war was over, the RFC sold all this manufacturing capacity to private industry. It had no intention to nationalize anything. It only wanted to save capitalism during the Great Depression and democracy during World War II. The RFC even orchestrated the development of synthetic rubber from the lab to mass production 18 months before the attacks on Pearl Harbor. And if it had not been for those investments and initiative, the Allied forces would have been stuck in place and unable to fight. In 1955, when the last synthetic rubber plants were sold, the New York Times reported that the program was in magnitude only second to the atomic energy program. I listed some numbers here I want to read. In Houston, the greater Houston area where I live and where my family came to in the 1940s as part of that massive migration, employment in the chemical industry in the greater Houston area in the 1940s went from 80 to 20,000. Population increased from 410,000 to 726,000. And that was all because of the investments made by the Reconstruction Finance Corporation during the Great Depression and World War II. And it's important to know the RFC was embraced by Republicans, Democrats, liberals, and conservatives. It touched the lives of every American citizen and business. The RFC during the Great Depression made loans to every congressional district in the nation, and its industrial plants that it built were spread out throughout the entire country to have a massive multiplying effect on employment, on industrialization, and on manufacturing. A new infrastructure bank modeled after what the RFC did during the Great Depression and World War II can address our daunting challenges today with no new taxes, no new federal debt, and employ millions of people with new good paying jobs. Thank you.
Thank you, Stephen, as always. Next, we're going to have a panelist provide a perspective with regard to employment and labor and why it is so important, as we've emphasized in this presentation, reinvigorating our manufacturing industries is critical for the recovery of America economically as we go forward. So our next panelist, I'm happy to introduce to you, Jason Parker, president of the Virginia State Building and Construction Trades Council. Jason, welcome, and the floor is yours.
Thank you, Jack. I'd like to start off, there's a comment from, or a question from Anthony Martinez, and I'd like to start off with that. He says, can you comment on our national security interests that mandate us to upgrade our infrastructure? You know, if you take a look at manufacturing, it is influenced around the world, and China is flexing its muscles right now, utilizing its massive manufacturing base to influence policy and and peoples around this entire world. And that leads me into talking about a meeting we had as the AFL-CIO here in the state of Virginia with Senator Mark Warner. You know, when this pandemic broke out, we had a meeting with him in the summer, and he told us flat out, it was, hey, look, guys, we're going to have to get the PPE we need to protect ourselves from China. And that's a pretty sobering bit of commentary that just teaches you that without manufacturing, you're underprepared for the challenges of the future. And there will be many as technologies continue to increase and get more dangerous as they do. And I'll give you a couple of items that really, really kind of make me wonder about our state right now in manufacturing. Renewables, chip manufacturing. I don't think it takes much effort to look around and recognize that every aspect of our lives now has computer chips in some form of minor AI or automation involved in it. And we're not making those chips. We don't know what's in those chips. We know that if someone was to cut those chips off from us, we would be in some extreme trouble. It's in our roads, our airports, our bridges, our power sources. It's in our military. And this is a very serious bit of national security. And here's the other one is the renewables. As we change our portfolio to these renewables, if we're not our energy portfolio, if we're not manufacturing them, we suffer the same Achilles heel. Someone can cut us off from those sources of maintenance items and other items we need, and we would be in a very serious bit of business if we were not able to quickly manufacture those items. If you go on the internet, it doesn't take very long for you to see that there's a lot of talk about infrastructure and its relationship to manufacturing. And these ideas go back a long, long, long way. Deficits in infrastructure and energy lead to effects on cost, delays, reduction in productivity. These are toxic items to manufacturers. And you know, you absolutely have to have multiple items for manufacturers to even begin to exist in a space, like for roads, bridges, railways, water supplies, utilities, land. There's a big one. Everybody can't continuously stack up in the urban areas. We've got to spread some of that manufacturing out. And to do that, as many different panelists have said, you've got to spread out that network of infrastructure. We are right now, we don't invest enough in our infrastructure as stated. We do what, 2.5% compared to 8% on China. And if you think about that, that leaves no reason for manufacturers to come back. And that leaves the American people, one, without a future. I mean, in a capitalist society, you need jobs. And I think we've noticed this year, as we watched our society turn very chaotic, it started, the catalyst was clearly racial tensions with our police force. But the fact of the matter is, that's a much deeper well of concern from our young people. They don't feel like stakeholders anymore. They don't see a future in the gig economy. So if you go into the manufacturing component as a building trades president, you put all of these people and you train all these people in these different disciplines in the construction field, and you give them real opportunities with Davis-Bacon wages. But those same people, as the manufacturers are built and come back, will retool and become the technicians and specialists within those manufacturers. I found a interesting, and it's from Britain, it's Duffy, Dino, and Eberts, and it's a quote from 1991. It says, "The importance of public capital in regional growth stems from its effect on production and location decisions from private industry." So this item is not new. This bank is not novel. It is not also an archaic idea. It's something our competitors use against us every day. And if we can't bring that manufacturing back, we're putting our future as a country and as a people in very serious challenges and in trouble. So with that, I will relinquish my time, and I appreciate the opportunity to speak to everyone, and thank you.
Thank you, Jason. Greatly appreciate that take, which is spot on. Our next presenter is a true authority on broadband. And as we have witnessed as a result of the pandemic, that is a critical piece of infrastructure that we need improved, not only for our economy, but also for our education and our youth and business and government to perform efficiently and effectively. So with that, I'm happy to introduce to you Erica White, the president of the CWA Local 4319 and vice president of the Northwest Ohio AFL-CIO. Erica, welcome.
I appreciate that. I'm excited to be with everyone tonight. And I'm the only person that does not have a broadband, a PowerPoint presentation, which is going to be exciting because then you can live where we are right now with broadband. Like we're kind of like in the dark ages, right? Compared to other people. So I'm going to ask you to use your imagination here. So the first thing I want to share is the insufficient supply and overwhelming demand. Okay, so let me start over. So the insufficient supply, okay? We have an insufficient supply and overwhelming demand growth, which are the strong foundations for why I believe in the National Infrastructure Bank. We're talking about fiber and broadband investment. To meet future needs, the United States needs an estimated of $130 to $150 billion into fiber infrastructure investment, okay? And that's a huge number, but I want you to think about what this is going to do. So what I'm focusing on tonight is extending fiber deeper into communities. So we call this deep fiber into communities as a critical economic driver. So even though we're making this investment, what is our ROI? What is our rate, our return on that investment? So today, the bulk of traffic carried by those wired broadband networks, most of us, we're on video, right? So we use it for video, for entertainment, and for information purposes. Streaming video and new forms of immersive media such as virtual reality are at the tips of expanded technologies that we'll see with this investment in broadband and what cannot be imagined but actually actualized, okay, by users and communities. What we do know is fiber to the home and businesses will be necessary to support the future of content delivery, okay? That's where we are right now. In order for us to compete globally and also to be able to build where we are in this country, we have to work on content delivery, and that's going to include videos, yes, gaming, AR and VR, which is our virtual reality, yet to be invented new content and application platforms. So if you think about what Windows did, you know, to the DOS, where we had to type in /:// really showing my age here, right? But yes, what did Windows do? What did that technology allow? Think of everything that birthed out of Windows, okay? That is what we're talking about, is we're talking about an expansion like that, not with computers, but with fiber and broadband investment. So just to talk about some of that, we're talking about autonomous vehicles and drones. So I know some of you are like, I'm not with the drone thing, but you got to think about autonomous vehicles as we talk about our society aging and people finding it more economic to live at home rather than going in nursing homes. We saw what happened with COVID. Autonomous vehicles allow people not only to have delivery service, which we're all enjoying, right? Pulling up, they put the deliveries in the back, the groceries in the back of your car, or they're delivering to your home, but autonomous vehicles. And so when you think about, oh my goodness, so that's what I'm sure you're thinking about, like Jason and myself and other people that represent working people, we're getting rid of drivers. No, we're going to work on developing new jobs that will build building those vehicles or commanding those vehicles from a center. And what it also means to the growth of what for people that are disabled or unable to get out their homes. We're talking about edge computing, augmented reality, and virtual reality. These are things that aren't just, so you can't just think of what we saw playing video games and that. We're talking about you actually having a virtual reality visit with your doctor, possibly. We're talking about things we've only imagined, being able to see other countries through virtual reality, being able to visit and do things and say, oh yeah, I would love to visit New Zealand because I went on a virtual reality tour and this is where I want to go and stay. So there are things we're not even being able to think about yet because we're not there until we are able to make a full investment into broadband and fiber deployment. So digital collaboration tools. I want you to think about both our rural and urban communities, what farmers will be able to do. And I'm not just talking about corporate farms. I'm talking about people that we know that own farms still in local communities, that what they'll be able to do as far as helping maybe a farmer in Africa, and what we can do as far as building out irrigation systems or getting new ideas and new development. This is what we'll be able to grow, not just in our corporations and businesses, but with new technologies, allowing people that are already doing this work to expand beyond just the little confines or holds of where they are as far as whatever. And so it's so vast to think about whatever their professions are, or whatever their skill set is. We also have physical robotics and automation. So I know this is another one where people think of iRobot, but I want you to think beyond that, okay? A lot of things we have already are doing this. So think about your Alexa actually being able to do more than most people think to spy on you, right? Lord, if your Alexa could actually have your dinner started before you get home, or remind your mom to take her medicine, or call the automated car and remind them to take your mom to her doctor's appointment, or your dad or your loved one. There are a lot of things we have to think about that technology just isn't for selfish innovation, but it actually allows us in society to be able to take care of ourselves and each other. The other thing is robotic process automation or intelligent automation, advanced cyber defense. That is something that's, look, we can talk about this all day long. How many of y'all have been received an email that your information has been stolen or may have been hacked, and it's with all the stuff you have to do. Part of that, because we don't invest into what we're talking about, broadband. That's one of the things we'll be able to do, is to really protect ourselves cyberly. And we saw what also happened with elections. I don't even have to go into that. Blockchain, cloud computing. We're just right here when we're talking about what we're able to do with the cloud. There is so much more to develop and move beyond. And I would like to add that when you think that only a couple countries are actually using the technology, why the rest of us aren't on board when we think about the United States of America, is because we don't have the technology to plug into what always is going on and also build beyond that. And okay, this is going to include hybrid and multi-cloud, which is awesome. AI, natural language processing, computer vision, 3D printing that's already there but has not went too much farther because we don't have the capacity to do that, in quantum computing. So let's think about this in terms which I kind of hinted on for our community. We can build a stronger education system, and we can also get the chance to reform our workforces to not just be technologies or being able to, I would say, moving more into the greener jobs that are gonna preserve our communities and our earth for generations going forward, also expanding the growth of hometown farms and not just corporate farms, which we've seen what that's done to local farmers. We want to be able to do that. How do we make our farmers more business-like and new businesses in rural communities? So the biggest thing I want you to think about here is the spinoff of when we invest fiber, deep fiber, into communities where that is needed, how they're able then to expand people to come and visit smaller towns and see what they have going on, how we're able then to have automated cars and a way for people to get to those areas, and also to grow and develop businesses, which feed into the tax base, which when we talked about that 130 to 150 billion, right? How do we take that billion and actualize it into community after community after community? When we're talking healthcare, we're talking jobs, we're talking about new industries, we're talking about a potential for growth that many of us haven't even imagined. So on my side, and when it comes to broadband, we are just at the tip of what we're going to be able to do if we were really to make a true investment into broadband, not just in deployment, but into people's lives, everyday people's lives, and building out into the future. So thank you for my presentation, and I hope I made you a little more excited about broadband.
Thank you very much, Erica. You have. And not only have we had the topics of broadband be discussed and high-speed rail, and also the national security interests that are involved, as mentioned by Jason, but we also have other aspects of infrastructure that's also important, and that includes water delivery and power transmission. And next up, our panelist Mark Strand, the president of the Central New Mexico Central Labor Council, is going to discuss those topics and other matters. So Mark, welcome, and the floor is yours. Take it away.
Thank you. Thank you so much for having me. The most important thing that the National Infrastructure Bank could do for the state of New Mexico is bring one of the most precious resources to our state, which is water. Right now, the largest lake in the state of New Mexico is Elephant Butte. It is currently at 9% capacity. If we can get more water into our state, we will be able to expand our local farming and our manufacturing. Water and its uses are our most precious resources, and it would develop the infrastructure to our state and help better our economy. The other abundant resource in New Mexico is wind and solar. Currently, Avangrid owns El Cabo Wind Farm, which can produce 400 megawatts of power, and it is expanding. That power is going to be put on the Western Spirit Line that is just starting to be built now. Another major wind component in the state is owned by Pattern Energy, which is called the Corona Tie-Gen, which will be complete, which when completed will be able to generate 3 gigawatts of power. The SunZia line, which we're hoping to start building next year, will be able to carry those 3 gigawatts of power on a 500 kV line that will join New Mexico to California. With the help of the National Infrastructure Bank, we will be able to beef up the national grid to handle the amount of renewable energy that producers are planning on putting and transmitting on it. Of course, there is abundant sunlight with 270 to 280 sun-filled days here in New Mexico. One thing I would like to point out is that 1 gigawatt can power 750,000 homes, sorry about that, and is equal to about 2 coal power plants. Back in 1976, they had a plan on building waterways to get water down to New Mexico. With the National Infrastructures Bank, we hope to continue that and bring it down here where we really need it. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mark. Next, we're going to have a true authority with regard to transportation and rail. Stan was a 30-year long-serving executive of Amtrak Corporation, understands and has intimate knowledge about the railroad corridor running along the East Coast, which has some critical challenges that it needs to face that has not been funded for decades. So our next guest, Stanley Forsyk, you have the floor. Stanley, take it away.
Jack, thank you so much. And all the other panelists, thanks a lot for presenting so well. And thank you everyone for showing up for another installment of our webinar program to alert the people in the United States of where we're going with the Infrastructure Bank. Let me point out something that was said in the very beginning, and I want to come back to it, and that is the state of infrastructure right now in this country. There have been 3 generations of people who have grown up since Roosevelt's bank and the start of Kennedy's space program. That's 3 generations. And most of the infrastructure in the United States, no matter what it is somewhere between 70 and 200 years old. So infrastructure is a very critical issue. And I believe that it's been said by Alfeca and other folks that the National Infrastructure Bank is really the only way that we can take our infrastructure and build it up to a point of good repair. And if we don't do that, we're just going to keep on lagging behind and lagging behind. But the bank means a little bit more than just financing projects or throwing money into different projects. It is a systematic and a systematic process that allows the bank and the people and the citizens of the United States to actually integrate all of the projects that are out there. As Andy Kuhn said, and as Erica has said, everything is integrated. Everything is integrated, and the bank will have another side to it besides just loaning money or giving money out to fund projects. It's going to have a back office by which everything can be integrated. We know that the appropriations process doesn't work because we haven't spent any money on infrastructure other than borrowing it at exorbitant amounts of interest. And we're looking always to get the biggest bank bang for the buck. So we want to integrate everything. High-speed rail, that's an integration with different urban areas. And we're actually stretching out those urban areas to be part of the rural areas and all the buildings in between, all the manufacturing plants, everything has to be integrated. Broadband, as Erica points out, and Erica, I really enjoyed your comment about iRobot because that's one of my favorite movies. But everything has to be integrated. You can't build a water system. As Mark mentioned, water is very precious in New Mexico and Arizona. And there are many ideas for bringing water down from Canada and have a system of aquifers that will bring the water there to actually make it fertile for things to grow. But, and Alfeca mentions this every time also, every water system in the United States has lead in the water. So we have to build new water systems all the way around. So you have broadband, you have hospitals, you have schools, you have high-speed rail, you have commuter rail, you've got everything, and it all has to be integrated. So the back office of the bank is going to do that integration. It's going to review each project manager's project, no matter what it is, whether it be a broadband project in Indianapolis or Iowa, whether it's a water project in Allentown, Pennsylvania. It all has to be integrated because highways have to be redone and we need to dig up roads to put in some of those things like the water system, like the wastewater system. So everything needs to be integrated. And that's another function of the bank. Another function of the bank is to actually go out and do some of the research on these projects, because we don't want people to be shortchanged or put in budget change requests when they have to put in for a project. So we're going to study it very carefully. Alfeca mentions that there are several different offshoots of the main bank that will look at planning for different parts of or different regions of the United States. And that's going to be another function of the bank. And the last portion, and probably the most important portion there is the bank is going to have standard operating procedures by which it will look at every project, whether it be a manufacturing project, whether it be a broadband project, whether it be high-speed rail, whether it be an energy project to put in 500 kV lines or maybe even increase them, or how do we get offshore wind power into the different grids. So the bank is going to look at all of those things and is going to develop economies of scale. When we start talking about having all that fiber, it's got to be manufactured somewhere. And if the bank looks at it and looks at everything as a whole on a regional basis and then as a total America basis, it can develop those economies of scale. Because if you can say, I need 400,000 or 500,000 miles of piping for a water system, think about how more economic it would be to order that piping from one, two, or three suppliers, or buy that fiber from one or two or three or four suppliers. The price of each project goes down. Stick rail, which has to be made in a steel plant, okay, and then welded together for continuous welded rail for a commuter rail or high-speed rail, comes out in sticks. If we were to buy all that or order it all at one time, then you're developing economies of scale. So not only are we looking at each project, we're looking at a way to do it more economically. And that's why the bank is critically important to do just about everything there is to get all of the infrastructure done at one time. We missed the boat and we did not do anything for infrastructure as we entered the 21st century. Now we've got to get things done so we get ready for the 22nd century. And the bank is really the only way to do it. You can come up with all the plans you want for infrastructure, but unless you're going to increase debt, or have a national infrastructure bank, it's not going to get done because you need the money. So the question is, do you want to increase the debt so that your children's children's children can mortgage a few hundred thousand dollars before they even start their lives? Or would you rather have a national infrastructure bank, just like the other four, which ended in the black, supercharge the economy, put 25 million people to work, and get the job done? Thank you.
Thank you very much, Stanley. Now we're going to go to the question and answer portion of our webinar presentation today. And Alfeco, we traditionally go to you first with some of these questions, and I'm going to keep up that tradition. There's a couple topics that have been brought up as far as the Q&A is concerned. I'm going to ask for you to briefly and quickly respond to some of those inquiries. One of which is the stimulus and recovery bills that have been passed over the past 10 months. How much of that is really going to impact our infrastructure development, number one? And number two, Biden's proposed infrastructure policy at this point tosses out a figure of about $2 trillion dollars. Is that enough? Does that take care of everything that we are proposing? And would an infrastructure bank still be needed if the legislation was passed? Thank you, Alfeco.
Thanks very much for those two questions. So the first question about the stimulus bill, my understanding of most of what's in the stimulus bill is that it is an income stopgap measure to help fill in the hole that was created by the coronavirus pandemic and the shutdown of the economy last year. So what it does is it puts money into people's pockets directly with stimulus checks so that they can pay their back rent or anything that they need. It helps small businesses. It provides some money to state and local governments who were really hit hard during the pandemic and had a huge loss in their revenues. And it gives some tax breaks for people so that, that when their unemployment checks are extended up till the end of December, say, they won't have to pay income taxes on those kind of things. So those are financial stopgap measures. There may be a few little things that were put into the bill that that helps infrastructure in one way or another, but the primary focus was as an economic stopgap measure. Now, when we come to the next bill that the Biden administration is going to be looking towards negotiating and passing, that will be an infrastructure bill, which grew off of the fact that last year it was time to extend the budget appropriations for the normal five-year reauthorization for transportation infrastructure. That's the spending program out of the budget for infrastructure. And then it kind of grew in, during the election process into this $2 trillion idea to have a an infrastructure package that combines infrastructure spending out of the budget with maybe some climate change remediation measures as well. Whether what size that that final bill is going to be is still not clear. The range is anywhere from maybe $500 billion up to $2 trillion proposed by President Biden to maybe $3 trillion even mentioned by Senator Joe Manchin. It'll depend on how you're going to pay for the bill. And the difficulty there is that you are asking to spend a whole lot of money on infrastructure after you just spent a whole lot of money on the stimulus package. So there might be a push and a renegotiation over what the size of this is going to be, this infrastructure package, and how it's going to be financed, either with deficit spending or new taxes. Either one of those, any measure that comes out of the infrastructure stimulus package, however, as I see it, still will not be enough to cover all of our infrastructure needs. 2 weeks ago, the American Society of Civil Engineers came out with a new report card, and they said that even after the federal budget spending plans, even after the state and local government spending plans, we still have a shortfall of $2.6 trillion in infrastructure. And this National Infrastructure Bank will be needed to finance all of that. And there is no plan yet for financing $1 trillion worth of high-speed rail. So our infrastructure bill will cover that as well.
Thank you, Elfeka. There was a question asked about how the high-speed rail transportation system would affect rural areas, specifically, for instance, the Navajo Nation that's in New Mexico and Arizona and other adjoining states. Andy, how can the development of a high-speed rail transportation system affect rural communities in a positive way and not just have it be focused on urban areas?
Well, the beauty of high-speed rail is it's a linear system. So even if all you're thinking about is connecting two major urban centers, you're automatically going to cross through a number of other regions with small cities and other states. So all over the world, when these systems get built, what happens is they connect with all those small towns and cities and give them access to the system. And then what happens is you have all sorts of benefits that then follow. You have, because it opens up miles and miles of affordable housing, entire affordable cities. Entire towns are affordable when they're more rural or they're further from the population centers. That's really how property values and housing prices are in this country. The closer you are to the core of the centers of all the jobs, the higher the housing is. And that's San Francisco, New York, Chicago. Those are some of the super hot spots. And what high-speed rail does is it takes away the heat from those places and distributes it for miles across a region to all the smaller places. So, you know, that brings life and investment and economic development to the small towns. But what it also does in reverse, the people who live in those small towns actually now have access to a whole world of opportunities. So, you know, it's easy. You just go right down to the local train station. You may have to transfer from one train to another, but you're on the high speed system at that point and the whole country you have access to. So it's incredible what it'll do for both, you know, the hot spots and the second tier. And we've seen this happen. This isn't just conjecture. We've seen this happen all over Europe and all over China and other Asian countries that have this. There's decades of proof of this.
Thank you, Andy. I'm going to also have Mark comment on that particular question. It's not only high-speed rail that is going to have an impact on rural communities, but there's also other infrastructure development that affects them. And Mark, just wanted to give you a chance to comment about the needs, not only what you have spoken to earlier, but other aspects of New Mexico that would benefit from having the tool, economic tool of a national infrastructure bank to fund additional manufacturing and infrastructure.
You know, a lot of our manufacturing is based off of water. That's why I brought up water as our number one thing. Back in 1967, they did have the Western States Water Augmentation Concept, which was a collection of rivers and dams across from Canada all the way down here to the lower Rio Grande Valley in the middle of the state of New Mexico. It comprised of tunnels, 56 miles of tunnels, pumps, and basically was almost 55 miles of open canal system. That was to bring water down into this area. With the water, we rebuild everything. Even Intel, the chip manufacturer up here, produces with a lot of water just to run their chips. It's amazing how big that plant is to build one little bitty microchip. I mean, it's huge. The water that we have out here is just very much needed. We need to really expand upon it. And this is one way to do it. Pipe it in, canal it in, pump it up. We really need it and desperately want it out here. So the National Infrastructure Bank would mostly help us get that. That is one way with the local concrete and everything else, it produces all the jobs to get it here. And I think it's very important.
Thank you very much, Mark. Another question that we've received made comment about the new Secretary of Commerce, the governor or former governor of Rhode Island, Raimondo, and asked what kind of experience and knowledge and understanding can we gain from Rhode Island, which has an infrastructure bank in part functioning and operating there. I think it's only for a narrow focus. And I'm going to ask Stan if you might be able to comment on that. And if not, we'll toss it to someone else. Stan?
The only thing I would comment on is Rhode Island is similar to other states who have statewide infrastructure banks. We see those state infrastructure banks as working in conjunction with the National Infrastructure Bank because if they want to get involved, again, it's an integration of ways to finance different projects. The only problem that we foresee with a statewide bank is they can't do interstate projects. And I think interstate projects would be the larger type projects. I'm not familiar exactly with what Rhode Island has, but we have spoken to the New Jersey Bank. We have spoken to the one in Pennsylvania. And we see our role, or we see the bank's role, as working in conjunction with those people. Alfeka, you might want to add something along those lines too.
Our finding is that those banks are somewhat small, and they aren't really banks, they're revolving funds. So even though they're present there in their states, and they do a chunk of financing for a very critical projects in the state, they still aren't enough, and they need still additional financing for the big ticket items, like digging up all the roads to replace all the water lines, building the Northeast Corridor through all those states, which is a really capital intensive project, replacing doing all the gateway project to replace the tunnels, and those kinds of things are still not financed by those projects. But we will work with them, and we really want to we're looking for inputs to talk with Secretary Raimondo on ways that this bank can really help to broaden commerce and relieve the freight corridors that are all backed up all along the Northeast Corridor, all around the city of Atlanta, all around the city of LA. We have these freight corridors that are backed up and reducing productivity, and those will be large scale projects which the bank could do as well.
Thank you, Alfeka. And Erica, I would like you to have a chance to speak with regard to the Department of Commerce. I understand that the broadband system on a national scale is addressed by that particular department, and interested in your thoughts about the new department secretary and the possibilities and opportunities that commerce will provide as far as broadband is concerned.
First of all, I'm excited about anything this administration does. I'm just saying, because we're finally seeing progress or promises being kept to from the working class down to poor people. So when I look at broadband, it's exciting to know that since the early 2000s, SCWA has always had a stance on building out broadband, making sure even when we were talking about carrier of last resorts, when so many big telecoms were pulling out of rural areas and out of urban areas where they didn't feel they were getting any return on their investment. So to see that this is now being recognized, broadband disparities allows us not only to build back into those communities, which were stripped of resources that stunted not only their growth, took away education opportunities, and also took away when we talk about access to healthcare. There are so many things that were stripped. Now we're able to build back in those communities with broadband. So whether it is while we're talking about bringing in water, what do we bring in when we bring water? We bring other jobs. We allow fiber building. We allow broadband to come into those communities and allow more people to be able not to only travel on high-speed rail back and forth, but allow them to stay connected to their homes, to their jobs, their communities. And also, we're talking about travel, right? We're all excited about that at some point again, right? So knowing what commerce does, when we talk about Chamber of Commerce, and those type of where we try to bring together working class people with the interests of building businesses, one of the big things we can think about is having people come in touring areas that normally aren't thought of. Why don't people go there? Because there's nothing there. Well, why isn't anything there? Because everything that would have brought business or investment to those areas was stripped out. And that is one of the exciting things when we talk about commerce. We talk about, and I like the way Stan said it, and I know that Stephen brought that up, when we talk about integrating everything on top of each other, what we're even talking about is just the tip of the iceberg. We are really going to be able to change anything of what we started building into something that not only changes where we are, when we just talk about clean energy, when we talk about jobs of the future, when we talk about what we see as far as healthcare and education, we're not even there until we make the investment. And that part is what's going to explode this country and put it back on track to making sure that we have what everyone needs in this country, which is affordable healthcare, public education. When we ask people, if public education is equal, why don't you send your children to public school? And, you know, people always are like, yeah, because it's not equal. When we talk about tax building and tax bases, things that make sense, this is where this makes sense to communities, both rural and urban, and we're talking about expanding communities we don't even know about. So it's exciting. I am excited.
Thank you, Erica. Next up, I'm going to have Stephen respond to two questions. One, if you could draw the parallels between what we're talking about today with regard to broadband and other infrastructure development and what FDR did in the 30s and 40s. As far as electric power is concerned, et cetera, number one. And number two, if you could just briefly discuss how the bank operated in relationship to the legislative branch, the private sector, and the public sector in its administration and function and operation. Thank you, Stephen.
Thank you, Jack. I'm glad you asked me those questions, because as I have been listening to the other speakers, I keep thinking, we've done this all before, it worked. And that, I feel, is my job in this effort to reassure our listeners and people who are interested in this bank. This was all done before very successfully. So to Erica's points, I want to say the way the RFC brought electricity to rural America and then helped people buy appliances on credit is exactly the way we can duplicate that strategy to bring broadband and internet access to the nation in the most remote areas. It was done before with electricity. We allowed people to plug into the modern age by helping them buy appliances, which were all paid back with interest. That same mechanism can be used today to bring broadband and internet access to everybody in the United States, and then wire their homes and help them buy devices to plug into those abilities. To Mark's points about water, the Reconstruction Finance Corporation built an aqueduct 244 miles long from Arizona to California to bring water to the Los Angeles and San Diego areas. If that aqueduct had not been built, there's no telling what it would have done to stunt the growth of those areas. The RFC also made loans to water districts to build levees, irrigation systems. It made loans to municipalities for them to restore or build new water systems. Same thing can be done today when we're have such dangerous water systems and dilapidated water systems or non-existent water systems. This was done before to the RFC through lending to state and local municipalities, governments, and institutions to restore their water systems. And to Stan's point, I want to about being a back office and being everything comprehensive, that's exactly how the RFC operated. It didn't do one thing in isolation. And that's why an infrastructure bank, as we're discussing, is so important, because it can do everything in a comprehensive way rather than a piecemeal way. For instance, I'll use aviation again as an example. The RFC built tens of thousands of airplanes, but first it had to manufacture the metal to make the airplanes. It had to manufacture the high octane gas to fuel the airplanes. It had to build schools to train aviators. It cornered the market in wool and silk for uniforms and parachutes. And I'm using these examples all to say, this has been done before and we can do it again. We have a model. All we have to do is look at successes from the past for solutions today. They are there and we can do this again. Now, as far as your question about how did the RFC interact with the Congress, it would occasionally go to Congress for appropriations to expand its lending authority, and it was never once turned down. And when Jesse Jones was its chairman, for 13 years, he would go to Congress for an increase in its appropriation and its lending authority, and it was never once turned down. And oftentimes, it was voted unanimously. But all of those funds were ultimately returned to the United States Treasury, except for some of them that were for national defense purposes during World War II mobilization. So I hope that answers your questions.
And one final additional topic on along those lines. What kind of independence and administration did the bank itself have during FDR's administration, as far as independent operations, or was there influence as far as private banking is concerned, et cetera? A quick, short answer.
Yeah. Well, that's impossible. Sorry. The RFC, Jesse Jones and the RFC always gave the private sector first chance to do everything, whether it was through the banks or through corporations, and said, here are our needs. This is what needs to be done. If it was a monumental project too big, such as electrifying the entire nation, it fell to the government to do it. But the RFC always gave the private sector first chance. If they were unwilling or unable to do it, the RFC became the lender of last resort, and it worked. It was an independent agency, and some people called Jesse Jones and the RFC the fourth branch of government, because FDR would frequently turn to Jesse Jones and the RFC when he couldn't get something passed through Congress. He went to Jesse Jones and the Infrastructure Bank to have it done. Most specifically, militarizing industry in time to fight and win World War II, because the nation was very opposed to intervention unless the United States was directly attacked. I tried to keep it as short as possible.
You did great, Stephen, as always. Thank you so much. Jason, I'd like to come back to you. And during your initial comments, you were talking about China and how it is one of our probably our biggest economic competitor throughout the world, and the threat that it has as far as our economic independence is concerned in terms of national security, and what an infrastructure bank can do to support and bolster our national security interests. So I'd like to have you talk a bit more about China and how it relates to infrastructure development that's needed here in the United States.
There's an old saying, there are no trade partners, there's trade competitors. And when you look at China, that's what they are. And they're, the best part about this, or I should say the most ironic component of this, is that they're utilizing our moves. They have themselves an infrastructure bank. They put 8% into their infrastructure. They know to keep the manufacturing base, which is a huge source of their power. They have to keep the infrastructure there in order to keep those manufacturers there. For us to compete for those manufacturers, we're going to have to take a hard look at our infrastructure. We know that even with the RFC, and we look back at FDR's era, he had to utilize industry, but he had to utilize the bank to affect industry. left to themselves, industry is a different group of different interests. So he gave it direction and vision through that infrastructure bank. And that, like you said, militarized our industries and allowed us to win the greatest or the most destructive war in human history. And if I have the opportunity here, I'd like to answer Mr. Goodman's question, which is a very interesting question. He says, your panelist overwhelmingly represents organized labor. And that's just this panel, Mr. Goodman. There's been a mix throughout the different panels as they've gone through the webinars. And then he mentions Taft-Hartley. And then there, I guess the dot connecting is, I doubt that they will have much more effect on rebuilding the country's infrastructure. That's why we're in the coalition, because no one group can do this alone. And thus we joined this coalition, at least under my council and my AF, my federation here in the state of Virginia. And if you want to take it in the other direction, we have over 1,600 high-tech facilities training people right now in the building trades. We spend $1 billion a year. We utilize the apprenticeship model, which is the best model. And I believe that makes us only second to the United States military. We are scalable for at least the work challenge, and we're here to put a lot of weight, as much weight as we have, into getting this infrastructure into reality. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Jason. We're now approaching about an hour and 20 plus minutes, and I think it's almost time for us to conclude. But in the meantime, what I would like to do is have our panelists give a 30-second or so closing presentation about their thoughts about how we promote an infrastructure bank, why it is necessary, and what our next steps are in order to convince Congress and the country that this is a direction that we need go. I'm going to start with Alfeca, and we again ask that it be brief as if you can. Thank you. Alfeca, your turn.
Thank you very much. So a national infrastructure bank is needed because we simply cannot finance all of our infrastructure needs through the federal budget, even with a big infrastructure Biden plan, it still won't be enough. And we need this bank to provide the total amount of financing and the total vision and the total mobility to get the job done and to build out our infrastructure base. And oh, by the way, all without creating new federal debt deficits or taxes.
Great. Stephen, you're next.
Thank you, Jack. I want to add one thing to the earlier question. Another aspect of the RFC, which is essential for a new infrastructure bank, is transparency. Jesse Jones was accused of operating in a goldfish bowl because every time he would make a speech, he would talk about how much the RFC has loaned, how much it has been repaid, and what it had to allocate to spending institutions rather than lending institutions. So it's essential that the new infrastructure bank be transparent, and I'm sure that it will. And I want to endorse a new infrastructure bank because of my knowledge about what happened in the past. The Reconstruction Finance Corporation saved capitalism during the Great Depression. It saved democracy during World War II. And for the most part, as Alfeca said, it cost taxpayers not one dime. It enhanced our national security. It increased employment, industrial manufacturing, and it revitalized our vulnerable nation. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Stephen. Andy, your turn. You have the floor.
Thank you. I'd like to reiterate some of what was said earlier. Obviously, high-speed rail will touch many areas of issues that we face. And I did want to bring up, it is a major national security issue because our dependence on foreign oil is the source of our vulnerability and what drags us into these wars all over the world for resources. So creating a massive, powerful system, main transportation system that's oil-free goes a long way to start unwinding all that. But in addition to that, it creates millions of jobs, brings back U.S. manufacturing. It's the number one climate solution, and it's a huge solution to the affordable housing issue. So with all those, we call it the silver bullet technology. And this bank is one way that we can really build thousands of miles of it quickly so that America can begin using it and all these problems can begin getting solved. So thank you. We support this. We hope you all get behind it.
Thank you, Andy. I want to make mention at this point in passing, we did have another panelist that was scheduled to speak today, Yadonis Rodriguez, the New York City councilman, who unfortunately was tied up with his responsibilities with his position with City Council at New York City. So our regrets that he was unable to join us today. Next up for a short final closeout presentation, Erica White, we'd like for you to have your chance to speak to the viewers about your conclusions regarding the infrastructure bank and manufacturing.
I appreciate that. So I like to share one of my favorite quotes. It's actually from Jesse Jackson, where he said, "A rising tide does not lift all boats. Some are stuck at the bottom." And that can be directly seen, how we can see that what's going on with rural communities and urban areas, that even though we see so many great technologies and we see funding coming into certain areas, we've saw how so many communities have not actualized or been able to be a part of that rising tide, right? They're still at the bottom. What the National Infrastructure Bank does is it says we make investments in communities where people are, not just where big businesses, not where I can get a bunch of money back, but where people are, and we can grow our economy and grow into what we thought about, like when I went to school, where you could go to school and get a public education and do quite well for yourself. We have to get back into funding the way things were so we can grow where we need to be. And that is part of the reason I support the National Infrastructure Bank on the larger scale, that big picture piece. And how do we do that? We do that by making sure we're talking to people, whether it's city council, they're our voices, they understand what's going on. We're talking to Chamber of Commerce. We're talking to, I know someone talked about labor leaders, but labor leaders are also talking to other, to both Democrats and Republicans. This is not a divide here. What we have is divide that we're trying to bridge by bringing together. And the way we do that is by we're making sure we're supporting the National Infrastructure Bank by asking your Chamber of Commerce, you're asking your city council, you're asking Lucas County commissioners to endorse this, you're asking then your executive boards to endorse this, and then you're building this onto the state. The other most important thing I want you to think about, and I'm gonna leave you with tonight, and I'll be done so Jack doesn't cut off my mic. Like the 2 minutes at the funerals, which is probably a bad joke, but very true, because people keep going and are like, 2 minutes. I want you to think about the excitement around electric cars, that excitement that's been announced with so much the press. How the heck are we going to have electric cars when our electric grid can't even keep Texas going? Think about that. We're talking about how these brand new technologies. So is electric car only going to be available in New York, Los Angeles, Atlanta? Are you going to forget about all the mid-sized and small cities that also should recognize that technology and also be invited to build that technology? You've got to really think about that. We've got to be excited about where we're building, but who we're building for and who we're building to. So that's where I'll leave you. I want you to make sure you think about that is what this does, what the gap is that Alfeca is talking about, making sure that it bridges all communities and all people.
Thank you, Erica. Next up, Mark, I'd like you to give your closing remarks, and thank you for joining us this evening.
Yeah, thank you for having me. And first of all, I'd like to thank my council. We make up of 26 different unions here in the state of New Mexico, and they allowed me, they actually voted and permitted me to speak for them here, which is a great honor. All of us built together, we're here tonight because we support what the bank stands for. The Davis-Bacon Act, Project Labor Agreements, and Buy American. These are very important to us. We speak it all the time. It's about time that we actually put it in action and do it. And that's why we're here tonight, is to make sure that these main things move forward, because we believe this is the foundation of America and it should be brought forward and be utilized. Thank you.
Thank you very, very much, Mark. Stan, we'd like for you to have your closing statement be presented to the viewers. Take it away.
Thank you, Jack. Before I make my last statement, Harry Drummond, you asked a very interesting question. You're not alone. I have thought about Alaska. I was actually on the phone with some folks from Hawaii regarding the National Infrastructure Bank earlier this week. If you could text me or send me an email, I would be happy to address it in length at a later period of time. Anyway, I do want to say one thing. It was mentioned by Mark in the beginning. It was also mentioned by Erica just now. And that is the bank's back office is not only going to do what I said it was going to do before, but it's going to research all types of technology. And I think it's time that we start thinking about the shortage of generation capacity in this country, as Erica has mentioned, and as Mark has mentioned, the shortage of transmission capacity for electric energy. It's time to revisit nuclear power, maybe not the big generation units of years ago, but maybe the smaller compact ones that are in existence now. Because if Texas has a problem, everybody else eventually is going to have the same problem. Because in a portfolio market that is out there for everyone, it's time to consider that you can't baseload off of what you think you can baseload. You can't have 10 or more percent of sustainable energy on a grid that is going to need to be operating in good times and bad times. So I think it's time that we start looking at increasing the capacity of both transmission and generation and start thinking nuclear. And the bank will have a research area in its back office to do those things, along with looking at technology, somewhat similar to the Kennedy Space Program, because we have all of that technology now. And we want that to continue. Thanks so much for tonight. I really enjoyed it, and I hope you folks did too.
Thank you, Stanley. Last but not least, I want to provide Jason Parker with a final opportunity to make his closing statement. Jason, your turn.
Appreciate that, Jack. You know, it was interesting. I noticed one of the questions was talking about World War II getting us out of the Depression. You know, the more I've learned about the RSC is what I see is that infrastructure bank helped this nation overcome two very important crises that almost at the same time were stacked on top of each other, the Great Depression and World War II. So when you look at that bank, it overcame two unbelievably harsh moments in our nation's history. And that's the beauty of these banks. Because what Stan said, you know, there's something I found on the internet. It's not really a quote. It was just something I picked up off it. It said, innovation in infrastructure stimulates innovation in manufacturing. And I think that is a huge point to be made here, that when you invest in your infrastructure, everything is lifted. Everything at some point is lifted. And there's another statement I found. It was infrastructure investment is a very real policy option for the development and growth of our nation's manufacturing base. And I appreciate the opportunities y'all give me to speak. Thank you.
Great. Thank you very much. I'm going to close up my portion to follow up with a similar kind of approach, Jason, that you did. It's going to be a little bit more formal, however. I'm going to have a quote recited by Shelley, and it's as follows. The most unfailing herald, companion, and follower of the awakening of a great people to work a beneficial change in opinion or institution is poetry. At such periods, there is an accumulation of the power of communicating and receiving intense and impassioned concepts respecting man and nature. We are at a moment where we have to decide and implement a policy for our country that is going to inspire the citizenry and our leaders to go forward to rebuild and reestablish our country as it needs to be. And the infrastructure bank is the mechanism by which we can accomplish that task. Now, to close out our webinar for this evening, I'm going to ask that those of you that are watching, please go to our website and you will see gobs of information, very valuable information that explains who we are, what we have done, and what we're trying to accomplish. That includes many, many endorsements throughout the entire country by labor unions, by city council and state government entities, by individuals all across the country, from New Mexico to Alaska to New York, Rhode Island, Virginia, you name it, Georgia, they're there. And we have a broad coalition that's increasing exponentially. The past 2 and 3 months, we have more and more people getting on board. Now that the administration has passed the Recovery Act, they are going to be pivoting to infrastructure, and the dialogue and the conversation about policy going forward is going to be focusing on this very topic. We need to be ready for it. We also ask that those of you that support us and want to promote the concept of an infrastructure bank to consider making a contribution to our efforts. It takes a little bit of money to get this information out, and we are on the cusp of making this policy and this legislation a reality. We just need to have a little extra push over the top, and a contribution would be of great help and assistance in doing this. We thank you all for joining us. Please continue following our efforts. Please assist us in contacting people that you know and organizations that will benefit by having an infrastructure bank for our country. That includes most everybody. So we appreciate your support and your attention, and hope that you would join us for our next presentation, which will be in the near future. And thank you and good evening.
Take care.
He went on through the toll gate, and as he went through, he started picking up a little bit of speed, picking up a little bit of steam. He got on through, he turned, looked back to man, he said, well, I fooled you, I got pig iron, I got pig iron, I got all pig iron. Down the Rock Island Line, she's a mighty good road. Rock Island Line, it's a road to ride. Rock Island Line, it's a mighty good road. Well, if you ride, you got to ride it like you find it. Get your ticket at the station called Rock Island Line.